Welcome to the web tutorial, Introduction to the Panel Study of Income Dynamics. First, let's go over what you can expect to learn. We will start with a history of the PSID, followed by a description of the sample design, PSID-specific terminology, and finally, a brief overview of the PSID's supplemental studies. The PSID is the world's longest-running national household panel survey. The initial study, begun in 1968 and directed by Dr. James Morgan, was intended to be a five-year project of 4,800 American families focused on household income. It was initially designed to understand the dynamics of poverty in the United States. PSID family members have been interviewed annually from 1968 through 1997, and every other year since 1997. Adult children who leave their parents' homes to form their own economically independent households are eligible to join the study, as are their children and grandchildren. After several decades, the PSID has grown through this genealogic design to include over 10,000 families in up to seven generations. The PSID has four key design features that together make it a unique resource. It consists of a national sample, includes people of all ages, has a long panel of prospectively collected information, and has a genealogic design that gathers data from multiple generations of the same family. The initial focus of the PSID was on family income. Over time, the goals of the study and the types of data collections have expanded. In the main interview, in-depth information on family composition, housing, employment, expenditures, income, and program participation has been collected for many years. Questions have also been added to the main interview in new areas, such as health, wealth, active savings, pensions, marriage and fertility, and education. Supplemental studies are also routinely undertaken with PSID families. The PSID was originally funded by the Office of Economic Opportunity of the U.S. Department of Commerce. Over the life of the project, funding of the PSID has been provided by a number of organizations listed here. Today, the study's major funders include the National Science Foundation, the National Institute on Aging, and the National Institute of Child Health and Human Development. Next, let's take a closer look at the PSID's sample design. The original 1968 sample was drawn from two sources: a nationally representative sample of roughly 3,000 families designed by the Survey Research Center at the University of Michigan, also known as the SRC sample, and an oversample of roughly 2,000 low-income families drawn from the Survey of Economic Opportunity, or the SEO sample. This sample design allows more detailed analyses of low-income and African-American populations. Since 1968, respondents have entered the study in three waves: through demographic inflows, births, adoptions, or marriages, as part of a refresher sample of United States immigrants, and as a result of children splitting off from a PSID family unit to form independent households. This last feature makes the PSID a genealogic sample. Respondents can be followed and remain part of the active panel via the main interview for their entire lives. Each wave, some sample attrition occurs when a few families leave the study because they cannot be located or refuse to participate for two waves in a row. Response rates for the main interview sample have been over 95% for virtually every wave. Let's take a look at an example that illustrates how PSID family members become sample persons. This family has four generations of PSID sample persons. Shown in gray is an original PSID family consisting of two parents, one adult daughter, and a minor son. The adult daughter was not in the household at the time that the PSID sample was drawn, and is therefore not considered part of the sample. When the son marries, his wife and their three children become part of the PSID sample. His wife's ex-husband and daughter are not interviewed, although PSID learns about her daughter's existence in the family composition section of her first interview. If their daughter marries and has her own child, her husband and child become part of the sample. The genealogic nature of the PSID sample allows valuable cross-generational analyses. Currently, the PSID has thousands of pairs of parents and adult children. And for many families, information is currently available on three or even four generations with large enough sample sizes for analysis at various points in their life course. To create genealogic samples, the PSID provides data users with the Family Identification Mapping System tool, or FIMS. A separate web tutorial explains how to use FIMS. It's helpful to learn some PSID terminology before beginning research with the data. Many of these terms are fundamental to understanding the different categories of people, respondents, and others and their relationships within the study. The PSID collects information on sample members and the group of people with whom they live as a family, which is called a family unit. Family unit members are almost always related by blood, marriage, or adoption, and they all live in the same household. Occasionally, an unrelated person who is permanently living in a household, sharing both family income and expenses, may be included in the family unit. A split-off family consists of a person or group of people, at least one of whom is being followed, who leave a main PSID family to form a new family unit. The new family unit must be economically independent and in a separate household unit. The person or group of people in the split-off family must be followable. Individuals who move into an institution such as college or prison or another family unit within the panel study are not considered split-offs. The household unit is the physical dwelling where the members of the family unit reside. It can be a house, townhouse, apartment, or room in a rooming house. Not everyone living in a household unit is automatically a part of the family unit. Those who are living temporarily in the household unit, or who otherwise do not meet the criteria of relatedness and economic integration, are not considered family unit members. A PSID household unit occasionally has more than one family unit. As an example, two family units in a household unit can occur if an adult child and grandchild who split off from a PSID family to form their own family unit were to return to their original family household. From 1968 to 2015, PSID conformed to the Census Bureau conventions in place at the time the study began by designating the husband in households with married adults as head. In the last 50 years, however, substantial diversification in both family formation and composition has taken place. In order to reflect these changes in societal norms, as of 2017, the term head has been replaced by reference person. This change is not retroactive, however, so in historical context in 2015 and before, we will continue to use the term head or head reference person. For each wave of data, each family unit is assigned a single current head or reference person who must be at least 16 years old. In single parent and same-sex families, the reference person may be male or female. For each family unit, the person designated as reference person may change over time as the family composition changes. Parallel information is now collected on household reference persons and their spouse partners, making the designation of reference person less central to the study design. Before 2015, a spouse of a household head was referred to in the documentation as a wife, while a cohabiting partner that lived with the household head for at least 1 year before the interview was designated as a wife in quotations, indicating that the partners were not legally married. Since the late 1970s, information typically gathered for spouses has been collected for partners as well. In 2015 and beyond, the spouse of a head or reference person is coded as spouse, while long-term cohabiting partners are coded as partner. This change also corresponds with the ability to identify same-sex couples in the data. The term other family unit member, or OFUM, is used for members who are not the reference person or spouse or partner. Considerably less information is collected about OFUMs in the main interview. Co-resident boyfriends and girlfriends who have been in the household less than 1 year are treated as OFUMs. Minor and adult children in the household are also considered OFUMs. Finally, college students and other members of households who are in institutions, jail, or nursing homes, are considered institutional OFUMs. The person completing the interview is the respondent. Either the reference person or spouse or partner is most often the respondent. If the reference person and spouse or partner are unavailable to conduct the interview, an OFUM may complete the interview, and in rare cases, a non-resident proxy is used. Some PSID information, such as reports of life satisfaction, is collected solely from the respondent, rather than both the reference person and spouse or partner. In addition to the main interview, PSID also routinely collects supplements to enrich data on respondents at different points in their life course. The first wave of the Child Development Supplement was collected in 1997. The supplement collected a range of information regarding PSID children ages 12 and younger, including health, cognitive assessments, parenting styles, time use, home learning environment, school resources, and socio-emotional characteristics of children and parents. Additional waves were collected in 2002 and 2007 for children in this cohort who remained under age 18. A new round of CDS was undertaken in 2014, with PSID children under age 18 in that year, and will be continued in 2019. When children in the original CDS cohort reached age 18 and left high school, information was obtained about their circumstances through telephone interviews conducted shortly after the main PSID interview. Begun in 2005 and collected biennially, the Transition into Adulthood Supplement collects information on psychological functioning, marriage, family, responsibilities, employment and income, education and career goals, health, social environment, religiosity, and outlook on life. In 2009 and 2013, the Disability and Use of Time, or DUST supplement, collected time diaries of activities along with disability and well-being measures from adults age 60 and older. The study included 400 older couples in 2009 and 1,800 older adults, both married and single, in 2013. Over 5,000 time diaries have been made publicly available. For the first time in 2014, the PSID used a mixed-mode supplement to collect information from heads and spouse partners, with the web serving as the primary data collection mode, and a paper instrument as a backup. In 2014, the mixed-mode supplement focused on child experiences in the Childhood Retrospective Circumstances Study, CRCS, and in 2016 in the Well-Being and Daily Life Supplement, or Well-Being. Separate video tutorials are available for CDS, TAS, DUST, CRCS, and Well-Being. To protect the privacy of PSID participants, some data files are available only to users who meet strict data protection requirements. Restricted files include, for example, geospatial data, Medicare claims, mortality data, and school identifiers. A complete listing and directions on how to request access to restricted data files are available on the PSID website. This tutorial was produced by Nora Insulera and Vicki Friedman in collaboration with the Michigan Center on the Demography of Aging, with funding from the National Institute on Aging. This ends the introduction to the panel study of income dynamics. Comments and questions may be sent to psidhelp@umich.edu.